Hello, we'd like to welcome you to the 2013 Channel 4 NCAA Tournament Preview. My name is Eric Lee. I've came out of limbo to help with this show, moderate it. We have a panel of three experts, or so they say, with us today. Adam Packer, he is assistant freshman basketball coach here at RHS. Rob Malko, longtime boys and girls coach, currently serving as an assistant on the girls staff. Rex Reinhold, been the RHS basketball coach for this last year, was previously an assistant. Tony Stasiak is unable to attend today. I think he was part of this show last year. So first of all, to you, Rob, your daughter has been an intern here at RTC. How is she doing in the Indiana State softball team? We'll start that out with this.
Well, she's doing well. She really likes it. She likes school. She likes the softball program. She's getting acclimated to the expectations of a Division I level program. It's definitely a little different world as far as how they go about their business. So she's got to be really organized, and she's doing that well. But she had her first home run yesterday.
Oh, good deal.
And so she was 2 for 3, had a good day personally. The team didn't win, but mom and dad are happy.
Well,
so,
that's,
you know,
that's all that matters.
That's what I think.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's going well. Thanks for asking.
Okay, so we may see her this summer on Channel 4 sometimes?
We hope so. That's the plan, I think.
Well, good deal.
I know she enjoys coming back and being here, that's for sure.
Okay. Well, the program today is about the tournament. The selection show was last night. I first of all want to get the opinions for the coaches. How do you go about preparing for a tournament? We'll start with you, Rex. It's different. I mean, obviously, you know well in advance when you're going to play Cast and when you're going to play Culver. But all of a sudden, they throw upon you, game one, you have so-and-so. Do you prepare just for that game, or do you look ahead of who you may have game two? How do you go about doing that?
In the past, what we like to do is start preparing around Christmas time. We look at the sectional, because usually you have a pretty good idea of who's going to be in there and games and that, and try to catch at least one of them live coming into it. Get some film on those teams, and then kind of prepare yourself for them. So, and then when you get to the final process, if you get that selection, you get a few more films and start preparing for that one team. You try to plan ahead, but it's the tournament, and you get an upset, you've got to be prepared. So we try and prepare for, you know, all 6 or 7 teams in our sectional, just in case. And then as we get closer to sectional time, we kind of take a look forward into the regional and see who we might play to catch coming through. So we do a lot of homework and a lot of studying and getting some stuff around for the guys, just to prepare in a week. To 10 days, it's really tough to do to get film in and get prepared for it. So it's a process that we start with around Christmas time.
Okay. And then, Rob, obviously you were the coach when the Zebras went to the state final. So let's say you were a coach on an NCAA team. How difficult is it to prepare for the different styles? You get the VCU full court press the whole game, or you get the Wisconsin swing the gate style. I mean, and then your backups, how can you get them to run this stuff to help your team prepare? How difficult is that?
Well, you know, I think, going back to that run we had when Rex and I were coaching together, you know, I think it's a mixed bag, because you go into it with a game plan, and I know in a lot of ways you kind of want to dictate the pace yourself and force them to play your style. And, you know, we tried to do that, and I think you see that a lot in the NCAA tournament. I think that's one of the reasons you see mid-majors have success, is because, kind of like we were that year, smaller, quicker, and you got Big Ten teams who've got the 6'11 center, 7-foot center, and they're trying to keep up with those guards of a mid-major. I think that's why you see some upset sometimes, is the mid-majors sometimes force the bigger schools to play a little different style than they're used to going in their league. And then of course you always end up, sometimes there's a game where you have to throw out what you had planned at halftime and change you know, some things you're doing based on whatever the opponent has thrown at you. And like the Gary Roosevelt game, where, you know, we just needed to pack it in the second half, because it was obvious that they couldn't knock down a shot that night from the perimeter. So, you know, you have game-to-game situations in the middle of the game, and obviously your preparation, like Rex alluded to before. But yeah, I think that's the best part about March Madness, is watching the different styles and seeing how people adjust and how coaches handle it.
Well, we have 17 of the 68 teams in this tournament are coached by teams who are coached by coaches who have been in the Final Four. So we have a lot of experienced coaches in this year's field. I was going to start it out. We have 4 Indiana schools. Now, Who's your allegiance to? Are you an Indiana fan?
No, I'm a Purdue fan.
Yeah, we had a tough year, didn't
we? It was rough.
We'll just
CBI draw.
CBI.
Can we have a moment of silence?
Yeah. It's not fun when your team's not picked on that Sunday.
Did they make the NIT?
No, I'm glad you asked that on the air. They are in the CBI, which is like to the third level.
Wow.
Yeah. That's what Butler was in last year. It's just a way to get your freshmen a little time.
Gotcha.
Are you an IU fan?
You know, I am.
Okay.
Obviously, Corey Barnett going down there, and I was back when Bob Knight was there. I always liked
Bob Knight
watching him coach.
Yeah.
And, you know, the thing is, though, I'm a rare – I like Purdue, too.
Yeah.
I was a big fan of Notre Dame, too, back when Digger had Chapuka and Woolridge and those guys. So I'm kind of an Indiana guy in terms of the state and Butler.
Yeah.
I can't fib. Even when Butler upset Indiana early in the year, I was thinking that was huge for them to get, you know, a good seed in the tournament. And as much as I love Indiana, you know, I just want to see Indiana schools succeed. So this is pretty cool to have not just what I would call they're good. I mean, Indiana, Butler's shown the ability to go deep in the tournament. I don't know. Notre Dame, I'm not so sure. They're kind of up and down, it seems like. But as a whole, you know, it's good to see.
How about you, Rex? Are you a...
I'm a Hoosier.
Are you a Hoosier fan?
I grew up a Hoosier. I am a Hoosier. Graduated from IU. So.
Wow.
But, yeah.
All right.
The 87 team, the final game, probably what swayed me that way. Just
I think that's almost cool to accept him.
Yeah, there you go.
Isn't that what Purdue fans would say?
Yeah. If you can't get into Purdue, you always want to look for Indiana, maybe. But we actually got to shut our mouth this year.
We will keep the barbs to ourselves. Let's be good.
Yeah. So I was going to ask, I thought what's interesting is actually what you've done against non-tournament teams doesn't really matter now. And I was just looking, and Indiana was 9-6 against teams in the tournament this year. Notre Dame 6-6. 6-5, Butler 6-6, and Valpo 0-2. So Valparaiso did make the tournament this year, and they get the beauty of drawing Michigan State up in Auburn Hills, Michigan. So good luck, Valpo. So, but we'll be rooting for them. Do you guys think, before we get into the thing, do you think the Big Ten is as good as advertised this year?
Yeah, I think so. The thing about the Big Ten is it's just such a grind them out. I love listening to the basketball shows where everyone talks about, you know, the Big Ten, we just can't score and we just can't do this. There's a reason that you see Big Ten teams go deep in the tournament, because when we can't score, we can make up for it because we're not going to let you score.
Yeah.
So I think the Big Ten is absolutely as good as advertised this year.
How about you, Rob?
Well, you know, it seemed like what I heard is yesterday they were kind of bashing the Big Ten a little bit, the supposed people who know what they're talking about, the Greg Anthonys and those guys. Gottlieb.
Oh, yeah.
Which
he's a piece of work.
Yeah. you know, he, in that process, I don't know. I think that the Big Ten prepared them. I think they beat up on each other.
Mm-hmm.
If there is a fear, you know, did they beat up on each other to the point where they're wearing down? That could be a possibility. But as far as preparation for this tournament, you know, Indiana, you know, Wisconsin obviously had their number twice this year, but, you know, that's where I look at Wisconsin being a physical presence, and Indiana likes to run. But, you know, Indiana goes to Illinois, and Illinois is in the tournament and got them. Indiana goes up to Minnesota, and, you know, it's just, and Indiana is a number one seed. So, you know, the Big Ten was deep.
No question.
It'll be interesting to see whether or not it plays out where the schedule prepared them, or did the grind take too much away? And you know, we'll know that in about 3 weeks.
Yeah. How about you, Rex? Any thoughts on the Big Ten?
I think what the Big Ten does, the strength of the schedule and the way they play, is the half-court defense. You get the NCAA tournament, you know, your style, if you're used to running and trapping and stuff, you don't get that. But the way you have to be so physical and aggressive in the half-court defense, I think really prepares the Big Ten for, you know, getting guys to the Sweet 16, Elite Eight, you know, Final Fours, with Michigan State getting there several times. So I think that's what prepares the Big Ten, and I think it gets us the respect across the country is when you get to that half-court set and you're really have to just buckle down for 35 seconds to get a stop. They're able to do that because it's so physical, and you've got a game plan and strategize how you're going to stop their leading guys. So I think it's important that, you know, they do beat up on each other through the year, but I think they learn how to defend, and that's the important part for the NCAA tournament, is how to play defense, man-to-man, half-court, you know, and make those runs.
The only thing I was a little worried about being a Big Ten fan is there isn't that one full-court pressing team in the Big Ten. You remember Dr. Tom used to have that with Iowa, or So that's the only, you know, so the VCUs of the world might get some Big Ten teams some troubles just because that's the one style nobody seems to have in there. But I also worry a little bit about referees. Big Ten is so physical, you always wonder if you go in a tournament and a Cody Zeller all of a sudden has three fouls 7 minutes into the game and, you know, how that can impact.
Well, I think as a coach, you always worry about the referees.
Yeah.
They're always an issue.
There's no question.
You never know what you're going to get.
There's no question.
You know, funny you brought the officials up. I was watching the tournament championship games, and a lot of the Big Ten officials that we had were scattered throughout. Mm-hmm. So I'm hoping that that's a change of venue that we're seeing, so we don't get, you know, the Big Ten officials allow us to beat the crap out of each other.
And that's what happens.
You get the ACC, and those guys, you know, they run. Yeah. So you've got those two contrasting styles that hopefully they've got a balance of where they don't, you know, get into that trouble and move down there, because, you know, a lot of those teams are very physical.
All right, before we get into picking our winners, is there any teams out there that for lack of a better term, are there any butlers out there? I mean, you know, any sleepers that you can see once you looked over the tournament that you thought could win two, maybe three games that that maybe people wouldn't be picking?
Well, you mentioned the team VCU, I think, is that type of team.
Yeah.
And in the same league as Butler.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, they seem to have that perfect match of being able to make a run and have done it before. So, you know, the experience is there.
Nobody wants to play VCU.
No.
And Michigan would be lined up to play them in the second game, and they've been kind of faltering at the end of the year. So that's, I think you're right. VCU would be a pain to have to get ready for. Mm-hmm. I mean, how do you have your backups get that kind of fast to help your starters all of a sudden? So.
Yeah. And the other thing is the matchups. That was one of the things that, between the referees, like you talked about.
Yeah.
The other thing that I, as I coached and you got into the tournament play, matchups, they're huge. You know, how you know, like you said, whether it's not just man-to-man or zone, but just personnel. And sometimes teams, you got to be a little lucky.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's that item, that factor of officiating, like Rex said, with Big Ten officials and or ACC officials, and then, you know, who you're matched up against. It's a process that plays out that you have to have a lot of things go your way, especially mm-hmm. the deeper you get in the tournament.
That's what we looked at, you know, making a run in the state finals, is we looked at matchups. We laid all five guys down the floor and said, okay, we can win these three. We got to make sure that we get these two here locked up so we get there. So
yeah,
that's a key of winning matchups and see mm-hmm. how you can defend those guys. And I think that's where the half-court defense comes in. You know, let the officials do their job and hopefully the kids, you know, play with their game plan and, you know, they don't get too excited, you know, mm-hmm. get a couple cheap quick ones and then play from there. But
yeah, that's important too. Easier said than done sometimes.
Yeah, it is. Oh, it is. It is.
You know, not to get too excited.
Well, like you said, all it takes is for Cody Zeller to pick up two quick fouls.
Yeah.
And then that game changes, or Oladipo.
Right.
And, you know.
And every team has that guy. We just pick Indiana because they're local. Adam, do you have anybody?
Well, I think they're talking about matchups a lot. And I think if you look at Belmont is a quick team. They shoot the three real well, one of the higher percentage shooting teams. And they play Arizona in the first round. And so most people looking through are going to say, oh, Arizona, you saw them ranked fairly decent mm-hmm. for a big part of the season. But one weakness of Arizona's team is defending the three-point line.
That's interesting.
And so you could easily see a Belmont squeezing through and then probably have New Mexico in the second round. New Mexico's had a good season, but they've had some games where they're up and down. And once you hit that second round, it's a lot of luck's involved. And
sure.
So I think you could see Belmont come through. I think you could see UNLV. With the Bennett kid, I can't think of his first name, but they could storm out and take some teams. Although Syracuse is playing well, and they would have Syracuse in the second round probably. So, but if I had to pick one, I would probably I think Belmont.
So that'd be your sleeper, and you get Sweet 16.
I think they have a chance.
Okay, how about you, Rex? Anybody on?
You know, just looking at it, you know, I got to watch Oregon play the last couple of weeks. I think Oregon's a dangerous team.
Yeah,
I mean, they won the Pac, you know, Pac-10 out there in Ole Miss. Those two teams really kind of scare me looking at it. Everybody knows about VCU, and I think they're going to be prepared for them. I don't think they're going to make that trip up this year. I think they get past the first round, but I think, you know, you got to watch Oregon. The Oregon-St. Louis matchup is what I had in the second round, and I think either team that comes out of there could make a run mm-hmm. Sweet 16 or the Elite Eight, you know, with that. So Ole Miss impressed me too, but you know, I think Arizona is also a dangerous team as a sixth seed out west you know, what they've been doing. I know they haven't played well lately, but
right.
you know,
they've got talent.
They've got talent. You know, Sean does a good job out there with those guys, getting them ready. So,
well, you can't hardly overlook Oregon if you look over their uniforms.
No. It's a little
bit like they stand out. Notre Dame's new uniforms. Wow.
Holy cow. But, yeah. You know, it's got your attention, that's for sure. You didn't know.
One more team. I'm wearing my Indiana State sweatshirt, obviously. So the Missouri Valley, Creighton.
Mm-hmm.
And
they're
what
very
I like
good.
About them is that the McDermott, mm-hmm. that is now, mm-hmm. he's supposedly high on the list of pro prospects.
Yes.
You get one guy like that who can carry a team, get hot. There was a guy by the name of Bird back in the day who made that run. And the other thing that sticks out to me, I'm just going to throw this out there. I don't think a 16's ever beaten a 1.
Has not.
But if there was a year that it could happen, Kansas is a number 1, and they got beat this year by, I forget the team, was it down in Texas?
TCU.
And Bill Self was on a rant afterwards about how there might have been a time back in the day with Naismith who lost to a YMCA team, you know, and we know how good Kansas is, but I think there's been some, you've seen some things where some of the top seeds this year have been open to losing to. Maybe this could be the first 16 beats of 1.
Well, you never know.
Just talking about personnel, Bucknell's got a kid that can really score. And San Diego State's got a kid. San Diego, South Dakota State, has got a couple of kids that can score. So those kids get hot. They could go. They could throw you around or two through.
They kind of protect the top 4 seeds anymore. They let them play as close to home as possible. Like Indiana's playing over in Dayton, so that takes away a little bit of this upset stuff. But last year, twice I think the number 15s beat number 2s. Duke went out and Missouri went out, so it can
it's
happen.
Happened a few times the 2s losing to a 15, but if a 16 does get one, I want it to be known that I brought that up first. Okay, I mean that should put me someplace.
It's on the air.
Okay,
it's on the air.
Duly noted.
Yeah. All right. Well, we have our 4 regions, and I'll ask you guys to pick one that you think might come out of that to go to the Final 4. The first one's the Midwest region. That will end up being played in Indianapolis. That's obviously where Indiana wanted to be. The top seed out there is Louisville. The number 2 seed is Duke. The number 3 seed is Michigan State. So, past champion, past champion, past champion. So, who do you have coming out of the Midwest?
I have Duke coming out from the 2 line. They fell in the ACC tournament, but you look at the way Ryan Kelly's playing, coming off of injury, and they can do so many different things.
Okay.
And length can kill, and they have it everywhere.
How about you, Rob?
I like Michigan State, and what I like, and I don't think that this aspect can ever be overlooked, toughness.
Mm-hmm.
There's a point in every game, no matter what level it is, where you just have a will and a toughness that you're going to get it done. And if there's one thing about Michigan State and how they're coached and the way they play, they'll push the ball, but in the end, they're just tough as nails. And I like that matchup if they were to be in a situation to get to the Final 4. They got the experience, too. You know, they've been there, done it. And I think Michigan State has represented the Big Ten the most in the last 10 years.
By far.
10 or 12 years in the Final 4.
Yeah.
Now, they've only won it once, but they've been in the Final 4, I think maybe 4 times.
Yeah.
So, they've got a lot going for them in that respect also.
Right. How about you, Rex?
I have Duke coming out of the Midwest region. I had them matched up against Michigan State. I was really struggling with the Michigan State-Duke matchup there in the final Elite Eight coming out of there. But I just think Michigan State's got a couple young guards, the Applegate kid and kid from Indiana.
Johnson.
No.
Harris.
Gary Harris, thank you. Just a little inexperienced, a little choppy there, with it. I think Duke's guards and experience with their leadership, I think they get that out of that over Louisville in the Elite Eight.
Okay, we'll start with you, Rex, in the West. Gonzaga is the number 1 seed. This will be out in L.A. Gonzaga is the 1 seed. I can't see my paper very good here to see the 2. New Mexico is the 3 seed. Ohio State's the 2 seed. So who do you have coming out of the West?
This is my kind of my off the wall pick. I think Arizona comes out of the West.
Okay, going on a limb, number 6 seed Arizona.
Yep, I think they're the ones that come out of the West feeding in there. Just because it's no disrespect to Gonzaga, and I know Coach Stasiak's going to be all over me for this, but I think Gonzaga's a good team. But I think far as toughness goes, I think Arizona's got just enough weapons to get them through, to push them through to the Final 4. So Arizona over Pittsburgh.
Wow.
That's my pick coming out of there. So
that's going to be the wild region for you.
It's the wild region. It's the Wild West. So we're going to take Arizona out of the West.
How about you, Rob?
I'm taking New Mexico. Coach just mentioned about having an off-the-wall pick. And Coach Alford, I really like their athleticism.
Mm-hmm.
So I wouldn't recommend that everybody take that. That's going to be mine. I'm going to go with the fact that I'm a little bit of, I just like the approach that they take with Coach Alford. And I know his nickname is Noodles, but Craig Neal.
Mm-hmm.
And so maybe part of that's my heart.
Okay.
Would like to see them do well.
New Mexico. How about you, Anna?
I think Ohio State. Ohio State's been playing so well at the end of the Big Ten season and running through the Big Ten tournament. A couple years ago, we watched Stephen Curry just light it up, and nobody could stop that one score. And I think you're hard-pressed to find somebody who can score in so many different ways as DeSean Thomas.
Mm-hmm.
And so,
former Indiana Mr. Basketball.
Not a tougher point guard.
No.
Right.
You wouldn't want him guarding you, that's for sure.
Right. But then Aaron Kraft plays defense the Big Ten way, so he's also one of those guys that those three fouls real quick.
Oh, yeah.
Could pick up. There's just so much talent. Thad Mata's got talent all up and down from the one guy to the 12.
Yeah,
so.
I was a season ticket holder at Purdue, and I will say I thought Ohio State was the fastest, most athletic team. I thought Indiana was the most skilled, but Ohio State, they've got another gear on them that you just don't see.
But Kraft is like our Cody Zeller. I mean, for IU.
Yeah.
I mean, if he goes out, that changes that
everything.
Team because he's their floor general.
Mm-hmm.
He's not out there.
Yeah.
They lose.
And then Scott, I mean, the backup point guard Scott has been playing some pretty tough defense as well.
He has.
Now he's not Aaron Kraft by any stretch of the imagination, but he's done well coming in.
They are the hottest team.
Yeah.
So I'm going to change mine. my heart's in New Mexico. Common sense. Ohio State, they're hot right now, too. They played well.
Well, we're going to shift you guys to the North Texas, which is the South region. You have Kansas as the one. Michigan's in there as a four. Florida's a three. And the two seed is Georgetown. Who do you have coming out? Let's start with you, Adam.
Well, this is where I'm hoping Rob is incredibly incorrect, because I have Kansas coming out.
Okay.
Of that one. He's the 16 over the one there.
Yeah. You guys disagreed on Arizona, Kansas? Yeah, I got it.
I think Kansas has the McLemore kid, also a kid that can just take over the game. And, they have a lot of experience. So I think Kansas has, and, Bill Self is just great coach.
Last year's runner-up. By the way, the last 2 years, champions Kentucky and Connecticut, neither one here. For different reasons, but so we're going to have a brand new champion this year.
Yeah, I think that Kansas. Coming out of that bracket, I think Kansas is.
How about you, Rob?
I'm going Florida.
Yeah, I like them too.
I just think Billy Donovan, again, he's been there, back to back a few years ago,
mm-hmm.
About 4 or 5 years ago they won it.
Mm-hmm.
The SEC, it's not weak. I mean, it prepares you. I mean, it's not what I thought the Big Ten was this year, but they definitely, that conference is excellent. So, I like Florida. I'm just going to trust that Billy Donovan will have the fellows fired up and going in the right direction, and then God knows they have the talent.
Yeah.
No doubt. Rex?
Florida. Florida's my pick out of there. I think they're over Kansas just because I think, Billy Donovan and his kids, they're just on that, they're that team like we talked about, pressing, getting up and down the floor.
Mm-hmm.
They can change the tempo. Watching Louisville the second half against Syracuse over the weekend, they came out and pressed them and got up and down the floor. It was a whole other team for Louisville, but I think, Florida's that dangerous team. The bracket's set up just about right for them. UCLA's got a couple injuries coming through. I think they slipped through the Final Four.
Okay, and then finally the East, which will be in Washington, D.C. That's where Indiana's the number one seed. A very good Miami team, too. I thought the weakest number three seed in Marquette. And then the fourth seed, Syracuse, who very talented. They play a weird defense. So, Rex, we'll start with you. Who do you have coming out of the East?
It's going to sound really biased, but I think Indiana comes out of that bracket. It's not just because... I'm an alum and true to him. I just think you look at matchup wise, I think they've got enough weapons. They've learned some things down the stretch here that I think that they'll be the key team that comes out of the East region, just because I think they played better on the road. Some of their key losses have been at home this year.
That's strange, isn't it?
It is. And some of their best wins have been on the road. They go mm-hmm. to Michigan State, to Ohio State,
mm-hmm.
And pick up, and to Michigan to finish the year out. Those three wins on the road for me kind of just locked down that they played better away. And I was kind of glad in a way that they didn't get the Midwest, because I think we've played in the Midwest in the past. We've been very complacent because we're at home and we think we can let down. I think our kind of backs against the wall, I think it's going to make them play.
Okay. Rob?
Well, my heart's with Indiana.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm going to throw out something that a coach that I teach across the hall from at the high school told me about Indiana. And they got small guards. And that concerns me.
Mm-hmm.
But when it comes to the physical play, or sometimes you look at Jordy and he has trouble getting a shot off, it seems like. God knows when he's open, he's
a great shooter, yeah.
But their ability maybe to guard another team's bigger guards or get their shots off, that's something that I'm concerned about for the Hoosiers, even mm-hmm. though I want them to come out of it. Mm-hmm. I'm going Miami. And the reason I like Miami is that they got some men on that team.
They do.
You look at the bodies of those guys, and we're talking NBA-style mm-hmm. bodies. The other thing is their head coach, he's been there before with that mid-major approach. I can't remember who he led.
George Mason.
Yes.
Same arena out of Washington, D.C., by the way.
Yeah, and I just, you know, I like the way he's taken. I never would have thought I'd be watching college basketball and see Miami University as being, you know, they're always football.
Right.
You know, and they're down, and it's never really put them on the basketball map, and he has. And I just like their physicality and just their toughness and the fact that, you know, there's men on the floor when Miami's on the floor, and that can take you a ways.
Yeah, I think they actually play five of their top six are seniors, and one of them's a sixth year, so they average about the same age as the Lakers.
Yeah,
I mean, they're pretty old.
You're right.
So they are men.
And they look like it when they take the
floor.
Yeah,
they're big boys.
Yeah.
And Adam, who you got coming out of the East?
Well, this is an interesting bracket to me because I think the popular choice will always be IU.
Mm-hmm.
Especially given where we are, my head kind of wants to say Syracuse a little bit. You know, you have Carter Williams running the point there, but I'm kind of with Coach Malco. I think Miami has the real shot with the Larkin kid,
mm-hmm.
who could just go off. And there's another kid on their team that can scores in bunches too. And I'm just drawing a blank on his name, but mm-hmm. I think the thing that pushes me over the edge is like Rob said, you know, Jim Larranega did it at George Mason, and it's scary to see what a coach can do when you give him ACC resources,
mm-hmm.
and he's obviously, you know, that basketball mind, and so it's hard for me to pick against Miami.
All right, so here we are. We got everybody's Final Four. We're going to pick a winner. Adam, you have a Final Four of Duke, Ohio State, Kansas, and Miami. I'm sure CBS would be happy with that Final Four because they're all big boys. Who do you have winning it?
I think Ohio State. I think Fab Mama gets us this year. The more and more I look at it, I can't see. I think it'll be an interesting battle between them and Duke. But I think Ohio State pulls it out, and then I think Sellinger goes. They're not Sellinger. Thomas goes pro.
Well, I think he goes pro if they don't pull it out. But that'll be good. That would be interesting. Who would have picked Ohio State at the beginning of the year? But
yeah.
Rob, you've got Michigan State, New Mexico, Florida, and Miami. You got a great football field in there, Florida and Miami. But no, that's an interesting Final Four.
Yeah, I'm going to go Florida, and the only reason I was thinking Miami, but I think Florida. They just as I haven't seen a lot of Florida Miami games being up here in Indiana, but
mm-hmm.
the couple I have seen, I just like Florida's balance a little better. And so I'm going to take Florida, and I think we all know, based on this tournament this year, whoever does do well with their bracket is a genius, because I think there's going to be a lot of upsets. I think there's going to be a lot of things happen. It wouldn't shock me if no one that I picked makes a Final Four. It's just one of those years. So, but from what I came up with, I'll go Florida.
All right. And Coach Reinholdt, who do you have?
If I'm going to put my money down, I'm betting on Duke. I think Duke wins it this year with the Kelly kid back. Duke over Indiana in the finals. My heart says, I hope it's the other way. Mm-hmm. But I think if you want to look at two teams to match up in the Final Four to really kind of square it out, if we get that point, it's going to be Duke and Indiana. I think those two teams are the ones that I think would be a great marquee matchup program-wise. But I think Duke gets it in the end, 81-75.
There you go. So you've heard it from the experts. Channel 4 would like to thank you three. We have Ohio State, we have Florida, and we have Duke. So one of them just might be right. Thank you for your time, guys.
Thank you.
The second part of our tournament preview, we have what we call the AP poll, the media. We have Tom Baer, longtime owner, manager of a WROI radio station here in Rochester, and Val, and I'm not gonna attempt to announce your last name, Val.
Sitsuris.
From the Rochester Sentinel, been a fine sports writer here for many years. First of all, I thought, do you guys have any overall impressions of the Selection Sunday? Anything that just jumped out at you, Tom?
Not necessarily, Eric. I think there's a lot of parity in all the picks that they've made. I would have liked to have seen Kentucky get back into the tournament, but it's one of those things that they didn't. And I think the brackets are going to be very difficult to fill out and follow through this year to see who's going to win it.
Yeah. How about you, Val? Any initial impressions?
I think it's pretty clear that the committee liked the Big Ten, did not like the Pac-12 so much. Most of the Pac-12 teams were seeded lower than one probably would have guessed.
Yeah.
I think they rewarded conference tournament play. I think as frivolous as they seem and as much as they seem to be just about the money, mm-hmm. I think they really did reward teams like Louisville and Kansas for playing well in their conference tournaments, and they maybe penalized a team like IU a little bit.
Mm-hmm. Were you surprised that Indiana got sent away from Indianapolis?
Not surprised. Maybe a little surprise. I know IU has had more good wins, I think 7 wins over the mm-hmm. RPI top 25 or RPI top 50, which was the most of any team, and more good road wins than any other team in the country. But at the same time, they only went 3-3 in their last 6 games.
Right.
So they only have themselves to blame.
Yeah, I was looking, and Louisville was 11-5 against teams in the tournament. Mm-hmm. Indiana 9-6. But Indiana, of their 9, 6 of them were against teams that were seeded 2nd, 3rd, or 4th. So... Mm-hmm. You knew beginning of the year when it said Indianapolis that you had Michigan, Ohio State, Michigan State, Louisville, and Indiana all in that proximity, and one of them was going to get it, and the other four were going to be upset. So it was interesting. Now, Tom, do you have a particular team you follow?
Not necessarily.
Being from Missouri, I didn't know if you were a Tiger at heart.
I was telling Val before we went to the program, but one of the upsets that I picked because of a loyalty type thing, was Florida Gulf Coast defeating Georgetown in the first round.
Wow!
Because Florida Gulf Coast, one of my daughters attended Florida Gulf Coast, played basketball there, and I not sure whether it's their first time in the tournament.
It is.
But we'll see how it comes out in that particular game.
Well, you know, Florida Gulf Coast earlier in the year beat a number 2 seed in Miami.
Yeah, right.
Now Miami was minus a starter, but. So that'd be a 15-2. So Florida Gulf Coast, you heard it here first. Tom Baer, throw all your money
right
there.
Right.
The four Indiana schools. Now, Val, you are an IU fan. Is that correct?
I have a bachelor's degree and 2 master's degrees from IU. So
just the 3 of them? You didn't want a 4th?
No, I all think right. I decided to.
3's enough.
I wanted to move to become a sports writer, so I think it was time to get on with it. And thankfully, the son was happy to have me.
Okay, and now... what's your thoughts on these four Indiana schools? We have Indiana. I assume we can be talking about them a little more later because I see you guys going deep with them. How about Notre Dame? Any impressions?
Notre Dame, I think, has changed their style of play completely under Mike Bray over the last 2 years or so. They used to be sort of a kind of a run-and-gun, mm-hmm. a lot of three-pointers team. Now they're a slow-down team that uses about 30 seconds of the shot clock every time down the floor, and they've become much more of a defensive team. It's interesting how Mike Bray has sort of changed almost his whole system. I like Notre Dame. I like Notre Dame to get to win their first game against Iowa State, but I think they're going to have trouble against Ohio State.
Okay.
I would agree with that too. And Notre Dame is kind of like Indiana University in terms of wins, losses, some of the games mm-hmm. that they played this year that they should have won, they didn't. Some that they shouldn't have won, they did. So
right.
it's kind of an up and down type thing.
Both Indiana and Notre Dame, I would say, are extremely experienced.
Right.
Whether it be by seniors or just having kids who've been through this before. And with Connecticut and Kentucky, the last 2 winners being out, it's going to be interesting to see, you know, a lot of these kids haven't been through this before. You know, Miami's not ever even made a tourney in the last 5
yeah.
years, so we'll see. How about Butler? Can they be the Butler of this year's tournament?
Yes, I am going to the Sweet 16. And in fact, I was very, very tempted to pick them for the Elite Eight. In fact, I was very, very tempted to pick an IU-Butler matchup in Washington to go to the Final Four, but I like Miami a little bit.
I do too.
But it's the same Butler sort of mm-hmm. system and formula. They're more physical than most of their opponents, and they know how to get it done.
And they have a coach who mm-hmm. has proved himself.
I've got Butler winning the first 2 games and losing to Miami because I mm-hmm. think Miami probably is a pretty good powerhouse in that particular.
If Butler can area. Get by a pretty good Bucknell team,
right.
I mean nobody's ever heard of them, but they're actually right. very good. They play Marquette, and actually one of the games of the year, Butler and Marquette played in Hawaii back in November. And
Rodney Clark's crazy 3-pointer at the buzzer.
30-footer at the buzzer to beat them. So I thought Marquette was probably the weakest, in my opinion, of the top 3 or 4 seeds on any of the brackets. So I can see Butler doing that. And then, of course, Valparaiso, do they have any shot up at Auburn Hills playing against the Spartans?
I think it'll be a closer game than some people expect. I don't, you know, I like the quick point guard that Valpo has, whose name escapes me right now. But
it's a long one.
Yeah.
Well, Boggs, too.
Right, Boggs. You're at Boggs. Mm-hmm. And I think Appling has had trouble against quicker point guards. I think Valpo could give them problems. I think it'll be at least a single digit. I don't think it'll be more than a single digit game. I think it'll be pretty close. And I think Brokoff is a great player. He was the player of the year in that conference. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, I mean, I think Valpo is actually kind of underrated at a 14 seed.
Wouldn't want to play him.
No, that's right.
Okay, we're going to start, before we get region by region, do you guys have any sleeper teams out there? And by that, I mean somebody that's seeded below eight that you can see win two or three games.
I have Villanova. In fact, I have Villanova making the Elite Eight. I think they'll be North Carolina and Kansas.
Wow. You heard it here first.
Yeah, their shooting guard, Ryan Archidiakono, I think is how you pronounce his name. He's a guy who can get really hot and take over a game. And Kansas has been so unpredictable this year. They've been, at times, they've looked unbeatable. I mean, Kansas beat Ohio State at Ohio State. They won the Big 12 tournament pretty easily. But they've also had games in which they didn't show up at all. They lost by 23 to Baylor. They lost at TCU, who was probably the worst team in their conference.
I mean, right.
I like Villanova as a pretty underrated team, and I think they're going to make it to the Elite Eight, and then they're going to run into Florida.
Well, Villanova did beat Syracuse. They did beat Louisville, and I don't know if it was Georgetown or Marquette. So they've got some major scalps on there.
Right. I think Jay Wright has made the Sweet 16 at least four times in his career at Villanova. He's a very underrated coach.
How about you, Tom? Anybody pique your interest besides Florida Gulf Coast?
Even though they're number four seed, I wouldn't overlook St. Louis. St. Louis is playing pretty well right now.
Yeah.
And they've got the type of thing, yes, they've got if they get out of the first round, then they've got probably Louisville in the second round, which would be a key game. But I wouldn't look too far past them.
Yeah, St. Louis, they beat Butler three times this year.
They did.
Well coached, it was Rick Majerus' team. Right. He passed away. So Jim Cruz, who played for the Hoosiers in the late 70s, has taken over and done a fine job. All right, let's go bracket by bracket. I'm just going to ask you to give me the winner of your bracket. We're going to start out with the Midwest, which will be held in Indianapolis. The top seed is Louisville. St. Louis is the four seed. Duke, the three. Duke, the two. Michigan State, the three. To me, that is by far the toughest region. Who do you have winning that, Val?
I have Louisville beating Duke in the championship game.
Louisville to the Final Four.
Yeah.
Okay.
I have the same thing.
I want you to know that the expert coaches, none of them had the Louisville going. I'm going to give my picks in here as well. I also have Louisville. I think they're the best defensive team I've seen all year. Mm-hmm. Their guards would drive me crazy if I'm the coach because they sometimes just jack up shots. But they were in the Final Four last year, and if you remember, they were tied with Kentucky with 8 minutes to go. So I think Louisville's the...
Rick Pitino's very proud of this team, too. You can kind of glean that when you hear him in conversations and things. He's really high on this particular group of kids. And when the coach and the team have such a camaraderie like that, They could do pretty well.
Yeah, I thought beginning of the year, I thought the two best teams in basketball were going to be Louisville and Indiana. And I'm not so sure that anything's changed my mind over 4 months. Now, out west, you have kind of interesting because you have Gonzaga, a small school, about 4,800 students, representing the number one seed in the West. And they've been a really good program for years. Mm-hmm. Over here in the Big Ten country, we think they don't play anybody. Matter of fact, their two losses were to Butler and to Illinois. Mm-hmm. Actually, two teams that also beat Indiana, so who knows? But Gonzaga is the one seed. Ohio State, who's probably the hottest team in the country right now, the two seed. New Mexico, coached by Steve Alford, the three seed. And Kansas State, coached by Bruce Weber, the four seed. I would say that's the weakest region. But Tom, we'll start with you. Who do you have coming out of the West?
Well, Fulton County Superior Court Judge Wayne Steele would, of course, lay his loyalties to Gonzaga. And,
does he go to school there?
Come all the way out. But personally, I think Ohio State will come out of that bracket. You know, I consider Gonzaga, but I remember Eric Lee one time on the From the Bench program saying they may be just a tad bit overrated.
Hmm. I wouldn't listen to that guy. Val, who do you got?
I don't like Gonzaga's guards, so I'm not going to pick them. I'm going to pick Ohio State instead. In fact, I think Gonzaga's going out to Kansas State in the Sweet 16, so I think Ohio, and then I think Ohio State beats Kansas State to get to the Final Four.
Okay.
We've been looking at these together here or something?
I actually...
Okay, wow.
I actually am going to the romantic side. I'm going with Gonzaga.
Okay.
I think the people set it up for them to have the best possible chance to get to the Final Four. Ohio State's kind of a one-trick pony on offense, but they're extremely hot right now. But they got the biggest break, I think, as far as a two seed.
Right.
I think looking back on it. Now, the next one we have is the South. That is where Kansas reigns as number one. Let's see here. We have the two seeds Georgetown, and the number three seed is Florida, and four seed is Michigan, who's been on a late season collapse, but very talented.
Very talented, there's no doubt about it. Very young, but very talented.
Extremely young.
Right.
Three freshmen, a sophomore, and a junior starting. So who do you have, Val?
I have Florida beating Villanova in the regional final.
Well, that's right. That's where we have Villanova running through there.
I think Florida will beat Georgetown in one regional semifinal. I think Villanova will beat Michigan in the other.
Okay.
So I think Michigan, I think Trey Burke dominates the ball a little, almost too much.
If
Burke said, if he focused on getting about 10 assists per game, I think the scoring would just come naturally. And I think sometimes that guys like Glenn Robinson III sort of disappear.
Well, they do. And that's youth, too. And you wonder if Burke just doesn't trust his teammates enough at the end of the game.
Yeah.
You know, but he's won so many games. But just last week against IU, I mean, he missed a crucial free throw, and their other good player, Hardaway, missed a crucial free throw. Yeah. So it can go either way, I guess.
Michigan will lose to Florida, and Florida will advance. Michigan will lose because that ball will go up on the rim and just kind of teeter around there and then fall out right at the end of the game.
Wow.
Yeah.
You got the Gators. I also have the Gators. So so they have no shot if we all three pick Florida.
Well, Florida, I mean, they advance every year. They've gotten to the Elite Eight 2 years in a row, lost to Butler 2 years ago, lost a heartbreaker to Louisville last year. They're almost a good pick to at least go a distance every year.
And maybe have the most underappreciated superstar coach. I mean, Donovan's won two and been at least a one, maybe two other Final Fours, so the guy gets it done, and he's a Patino type of guy. Mm-hmm. Matter of fact, they may end up seeing each other deep into this. Now in the East is where the Hoosiers are at. That'll be in Washington, D.C. This Indiana group did go to the Sweet 16 last year, but it is their first time being seeded 1, 2, or 3 since 1993, which I thought was kind of shocking.
First Big Ten title since 1993.
Solo. They did share in 2002, the last time they made the finals.
I was at most of the games at Assembly Hall that year.
93 or 2?
93.
Okay. Well, as many degrees as you had. It could be 93, 2002.
It was a long residency.
Okay. Miami is the number 2 seed. They have 5 seniors. They have a 22-year-old on the team, as we were joking earlier. They're older than some of the NBA teams. The number 3 seed, to me, Marquette, is a little bit of a weak 3 seed. That's where you guys have Butler coming through. And the 4 seed is a dangerous Syracuse, because it seems to me if Syracuse wins their first game, they're in it for the long haul. But they're the type of team that gets knocked out in game 1 so often. So who do you have coming out of the East, Val?
I like Miami to beat IU in the regional final.
That was probably hard for you to spit that out, wasn't it?
That was tough.
Okay.
But, Jim Larrañaga took George Mason to the Final Four in 2006, I think it was.
Right.
I think he's going to take Miami to the Final Four this time.
Out of that same arena.
Out of that same arena, in Washington.
Yeah. Tom?
Well, to upset all my IU friends, I too had Miami over IU in that championship game. I did have Syracuse coming out to play IU, which reminded me of the 87 game when Indiana and Syracuse played for the national championship, and what a contest that was.
Yeah,
so that game in and of itself, a Syracuse and IU hookup, could go either way.
Actually have IU playing UNLV in that round.
UNLV is...
Which would be another rematch of the 1987 Final
Four. Oh, that's true.
Yeah. Right.
Well, you guys are on it. That's a dangerous team. UNLV is a dangerous team. I think NC State, who IU will play in the second round, preseason was number 5. They underachieved all year, but how many times have you seen a team that has all this talent, they don't listen to their coach for 6 months, and then it gets in the tournament kicking on? Wouldn't surprise me to see NC State give Indiana all they want in the second game, but I don't see them beating them. But
the memory of Jimmy V.
Yeah, I also see...
I think it'll be Temple.
Do you?
NC State.
Well, that's interesting. I've got Miami as well. So we all have Louisville. We all have Florida. We all have Miami. You both have Ohio State. You have the same exact Final Four. I have Gonzaga. So who do you have cutting down the nets on April 8th in lovely Atlanta, Georgia? Val?
I'm going to go with Louisville beating Florida in the championship game. I think Louisville will beat Ohio State, and then they'll beat Florida and win the title. I think they're the one team that can dictate the game with their defense more than any other team in the country. And that's why I like them. And I think the way they played against Syracuse in the Big East championship game sort of really put me over the top on offense. Mm-hmm. They scored 56 points in the second half.
Yeah, they score off that defense.
Yeah, that was... That was something. I think Jang, their center, had like 7 assists in that game. I mean, they really shared the ball well, mm-hmm. moved it beautifully. They played good team basketball. I like Louisville.
Well, you know, if Notre Dame hadn't beaten Louisville in 5 overtimes, Louisville would have a 15-game winning streak right now. Yeah. So they're playing good. Mm-hmm. Tom, who do you have?
I think it's Rick Pitino's year. I picked Louisville, too, and I picked him over Florida in the championship game.
Well, this is kind of embarrassing because I have Louisville over Florida, too. So there is no shot for that to happen.
I thought there were supposed to be a lot of upsets throughout this thing.
Well, I actually, it's kind of interesting as I was filling it out. I think there won't be as many as people think. There's a few out there. It'd be interesting to watch South Dakota State. Mm-hmm. I've watched them a couple times this year. They have a guard who's going to play in the NBA. Mm-hmm. Whenever you have a guard, it's a guard-heavy tournament. You know, whenever you have good guard play, which I believe Louisville does, the coaches pointed out that one thing they were worried about Indiana was the size of Jordan and Yogi.
Yeah.
Louisville's similar, too. They have small guards, and sometimes you get big guards in the NCAA.
If you watch Yogi sometimes, it's kind of hard for him to get shots because of his height. I mean, he's quick. He moves with the ball, without the ball.
It's hard to guard, but, you know, so often these freshman guards find when they get to the pin or to the hole, they're finishing over 6'9" guys instead of 6'3" guys that they're used to soaring over. So, you ask us, I guess it's a Cardinal way. So that's been your view from the AP poll. We want to thank Tom Baer from WRI and Val T from the Rochester Sentinel. And go Cardinals, I guess.